Hi, Pastor Steve here. I want to thank you for listening today, and I want to encourage you because I know that God will truly bless you as you study His Word. So hey, let's get started.
Well, good evening, church family. We're going to begin this evening by reading from God's Word and going to His Scripture.
Romans 5, 6 through 8 says, "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would even dare to die. But God shows His love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Praise be to God that Christ died for our sins. Please stand as we sing to the Lord on this Good Friday."
Savior, I come, quiet my soul, remember, redemption till, where your blood was spilled, for my ransom, everything I once had. To the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me, lead me. You were as I, tempted and tried, human. The Word became flesh, for my sin and death. Now you're risen, and everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Myself, I'm
continue to sing together and praise the Lamb who was slain. He is worthy. He is holy. We praise him this evening.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Sing that again. Worthy is.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I live for you. Of lightning, rolls of thunder, blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
With wonder,
filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name, Jesus. Your name is power, breath, and living water. Such a marvelous name.
Sing, holy, holy.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything. I live for you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything. I will adore you.
Lord, we thank you. thank you for this evening, this opportunity to worship you, to be in your presence. God, you are worthy of all the praise. Your name is above every name. We thank you, Jesus, for your love poured out on the cross. We seek to know you more, God. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Church family, you may be seated.
Good evening. Thank you for taking time out of your night to come to our Good Friday service this evening. I'm so thankful that we can all gather together as a church family and remember Jesus' sacrifice for us on that rugged cross 2,000 years ago at Calvary. My name's Ben, and I'm one of the pastors here, and I want to open us up in a word of prayer before we meditate on the cross this evening. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, thank you for this night, a night to remember your cross. Thank you for sending Jesus for us. I pray that our minds would be attentive and that our hearts would be receptive to your word this evening. In Jesus' name, amen. On the surface, it seems a bit puzzling to call a day like today Good Friday. What could be good about a violent crucifixion? Nails were driven through our Savior's hands and feet. A crown of thorns was placed on his head. People mocked him and jeered at him. They spit on him. The crowds called him names. And yet, throughout church history, this has always been referred to as Good Friday. The results of Jesus' death for us on the cross are beyond what our finite minds can truly comprehend. We call today Good Friday because of what Jesus accomplished for us on the cross. We call today Good Friday because of the hope of eternal life that we find through the cross. On Sunday, we celebrate Jesus' resurrection in the empty tomb. But this evening, our focus is on the cross of Christ. We remember the agony that our Lord put himself through on our behalf. There are seven statements or seven sayings of Jesus that he said while he was on the cross. Luke records three of the statements, John records three, and Matthew and Mark record the other one. This evening, we are going to focus on the sixth statement from the cross. Our reading comes from John 19, verses 28 through 30. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that Scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus says, "I am thirsty." And so while Jesus is hanging on the cross, it says that he knew that everything had been finished, and he knew that the Old Testament prophecies would be fulfilled. And in verse 28, he says, "I'm thirsty." Jesus saying that he's thirsty is a reference to prophecy from Psalm chapter 22. Psalm 22:15 says, "My strength is dried up like a piece of pottery, and my tongue clings to my jaws." John even alluded to the same psalm earlier in John 19 when he wrote about the Roman soldiers dividing up the garments of Christ. Back to verse 29. "A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he'd received the drink, Jesus said, 'It is finished.' With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit." It is finished. Three short words that change the entire course of human history. Three short words that give us hope for beyond the grave. The English phrase, "it is finished," is actually one word in the original language. You see, the New Testament was written in Greek, and the word the author uses here is the word tetelestai. The word tetelestai is a really common word. It signified that something had been completed, that something had been perfected, or whatever had been agreed upon had been entirely fulfilled. In the merchant world, it meant paid in full. If you were doing a task for your boss and you finished it up, you'd go to your boss and you'd say, "Tetelestai." It's a happy word. It's a victorious word. And when Jesus said tetelestai from the cross, he meant that once and for all, it is finished. This was a present tense statement with future tense implications. In essence, Jesus is saying, "It is finished, it stands finished, and it always will be finished." But what did Jesus mean when he said this? It's really important for us to be able to grasp the spiritual and theological significance of this succinct statement. "It is finished" means that Jesus accomplished the work that God the Father had set him out to do. Twice in the first chapter of the Gospel of John, we see the purpose of the life and ministry of Jesus. In John 1, there's a guy named John the Baptist, and that's Jesus' cousin. And John the Baptist's job while he was on earth was to prepare the way for the Lord, to prepare the way for the Messiah. So in John chapter 1, John the Baptist sees his cousin Jesus coming towards him, and how does he introduce him to the world? John the Baptist could have introduced Jesus as a miracle worker like the world had never seen, but that wouldn't have been a complete picture of Jesus Christ. John the Baptist could have introduced Jesus as the greatest teacher of all time, and he would have been right. But even that's not a complete picture of Jesus and his primary purpose for coming to earth. Here's what John the Baptist had to say when he sees Jesus walking towards him. He says this, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." John called Jesus the Lamb of God, which would have been very familiar language for his Jewish audience. In the Old Testament, lambs were sacrificed on behalf of the sins of the people. And John is saying, this is the Lamb of God, the ultimate sacrifice for sins once and for all. The Jewish people at the time, they couldn't fully comprehend what John was saying. But make no mistake, John was announcing Jesus as the Messiah from the very first chapter of the Gospel of John. Jesus came to earth on a mission. And his mission was to save sinners and to provide a way for all of us to be reconciled to God. The Apostle Paul put it like this in 1 Timothy 1:15. He writes, "Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst." In Matthew 20:28, Jesus says that he came to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus came to earth to save us from our sins. The culmination of his life would be his sacrificial death. He came to purchase our salvation and to offer us eternal life. He came as a humble servant and as a savior to all who would come to him. And we needed a savior because none of us can save ourselves. Jesus' death on the cross was necessary in the first place because a sin debt must be paid for. Every human being that has ever walked the planet outside of Jesus Christ has a debt of sin that we cannot pay. All of us were born into a sinful world, and all of us are sinful people. And our sin separates us from God. Why is that? Because God's perfect, and he's holy. And the very nature of God is that he is so holy, he is so set apart, he is so unlike us that he can have nothing to do with sin. But God loves us so much that he sent Jesus on a mission to earth to make a way when there was no way, to make a way for us to be saved. And in God's providence, the cross is how he chose to save us. When Jesus said, "It is finished," he was referring to his work being complete and our debt of sin being paid. "It is finished" means that the debt of our sins has been paid in full, tetelestai. When Jesus gave himself up for us on the cross, he fully met the law, the righteous law, the demands that God had set in place. Because the law required a perfect sacrifice, and Jesus was perfect. Jesus took all of our sins upon himself. The times that we've lusted, the times that we've lied, the times that we've known the right thing to do and chose to not do it, the times that we've envied others, the times that we've worried, the times that we've been hateful, the times that we've gossiped, the times that we gave up, the times that we gave up on doing what we knew that God had called us to do, all of those things Jesus died for. He took all of our sins upon himself and he paid our debt in full. And Jesus took our place. This is called substitutionary atonement. Jesus took the full punishment that we deserved. He took all of our sins as a substitute in our place. The word atonement refers to reconciliation. And the only way that we can be reconciled to God is through the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. Pastor Matt Smether said, "The heart of sin is man taking God's place on the throne. The heart of salvation is God taking man's place on the cross." It's important to remember that Jesus did not die a martyr. He willingly gave himself up for us in obedience to God's plan. In John 10:18, Jesus said, "No one takes my life from me. I give it up willingly. I have the power to give it up and the power to receive it back again, just as my Father commanded me to do." Jesus' death was not an accident that ended up working out. Jesus' death on the cross was the result of God's divine plan of salvation. This is what God had in mind all along, the cross. "It is finished" also means that the Old Testament prophecies have been fulfilled. Jesus fulfilled over 300 prophecies about the Messiah. In John 5:39, Jesus is speaking to the Pharisees, and he says, "You study the scriptures diligently because you think that in them you have eternal life. These are the very scriptures that testify about me." And a few verses later in the same chapter, he says, "If you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote of me." Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible. And Jesus says, when you read those books, you got to remember, Moses was writing about me. All of the promises of God in the Old Testament and all the prophecies of old are fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Jesus fulfilled what had been prophesied about him hundreds of years before his birth. And Jesus says, "It is finished." And we need to believe him. Because the finished work of Christ is our only hope for salvation. What are you banking on for your salvation? Is it your good works? Is it your intellect? Is it your family? Because none of us are good enough on our own merit. Paul David Tripp put it like this. He said, "He lived the life we couldn't live. He died the death we should have died. He defeated sin and death. He did it for us all, and his name is Jesus." 2,000 years ago, the cross was a symbol of torture and death. But for us here today, the cross provides the ultimate proof of God's love. And when Jesus said, "Tetelestai," he's saying, "I've completed the work that God had set out for me to do. I've taken the sins of the world upon myself. It is finished." And our hope for eternity hangs on Christ alone. Sadly, when it comes down to it, most people, they put their hope for eternal life in themselves. They think, well, hey, if my good works outweigh my bad works, then I'm okay. But the only problem is that God doesn't work like that. God's standard is perfection. So let's just say that you only sin one time in your whole life. And for one, this is quite the example because we've all sinned thousands of times. But let's just say that you only sinned once and you were a little kid and you told a lie and you're on the sin chart, you sinned. That one sin alone, if that's the only thing you ever did wrong, would keep you out of heaven and keep you out of a relationship with God. Because our sin forms this chasm that's between us and a holy God. And the only bridge to the chasm is a cross. There are essentially two schools of thought in the world for how to get to heaven. And it's either by God's grace, that's Christianity, or it's by good works, which is what everyone else tends to think. All other religions and philosophies outside of Christianity are on the good works plan. And it's pretty simple. Most people think that their eternal destiny all comes down to their performance. Statistics say that approximately 7 out of 10 Americans believe there is a heaven. And most of those people believe that being a good person is how you get there. It's how you get to heaven. But when you think about it, how good of a person are you? Because it's kind of a crippling system when you really consider it, because how good is good enough? Well, we're left with a huge problem here because none of us will ever be good enough because none of us will ever be perfect. Tim Keller said, "Every other religion and philosophy says that you have to do something to connect to God, but Christianity says no. Jesus Christ came to do for you what you couldn't do for yourself." The only hope that we have for salvation is trusting in the finished work of Christ. I want you to imagine for a minute that all of us here at the church decided that we were going to do a swim challenge together. And the challenge is this: we're going to go to New York City and we're going to swim to London. But that's not hard enough. You know, we want to swim from New York City to London. We want to touch the shore and we want to swim all the way back to New York City. That would be a 7,600-mile swim. So just imagine this with me. We all jump in the water and we start swimming, and we'd all have these great intentions to swim more than anyone has ever swam before. But before long, we'd be dropping like flies. And I'd be looking back at all of you and saying prayers. And next thing you know, no one would accomplish the goal. Now, listen, there are some people that would get further than others. But honestly, is that anything to brag about? Because if our goal was to go from New York City to London and back, no one's going to come close. Not one of us could do it. Nobody in the whole world could do it. So even if you got closer than anyone else in the entire world, you'd still be miserably short of the goal. The end result would be the same for every single one of us, and that's drowning. No matter how good of a swimmer you are, you cannot get there by yourself. And it doesn't matter how good of a person you think you are either. You cannot earn your salvation based on your works. The Bible says that our righteous deeds are like filthy rags. Apart from Jesus, there is no salvation. Trying to earn your salvation by good works is like trying to jump to the moon. It's just not going to happen. Because we can never do enough good things. Good works will not save you. Only Jesus will. And the way of salvation is not about what I can do. The way of salvation is about what Jesus has done. So how do we respond to this? How do we respond on this Good Friday in our lives? We look to the cross and we trust in the Savior. I recently came across the last words of Herman Bavinck. He's a well-known Dutch theologian in the 20th century, and he's regarded as one of the greatest Christian theologians of his time. And when he died, he had a really interesting statement. He said this. He said, "All of my theology does not help me now, only Jesus Christ and what he has done. That's all that avails for me now." Now, of course, Professor Bavinck, if we'd been in a classroom with him and I raised my hand and I said, but isn't that your theology? I think he would have said, of course. But what he meant was that so many of the things that I've built my life on and concern myself about are secondary. And the most important thing at this point is that my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. That's the only place that any of us can find hope. That's the only place that any of us can find salvation. It's through the cross of Christ. The finished work of Christ is our only hope for salvation. And so what we do is we look to the cross and we trust in the finished work of Jesus. And we remember that on Sunday, the tomb's empty to prove that the payment went through. As our communion servers get into place, we're going to spend some time this evening remembering Jesus' sacrifice for us together. In church tradition, this week of Palm Sunday, and we're at Good Friday now, it's known as Holy Week. And yesterday is considered a holy day too. It's called Holy Thursday or Maundy Thursday. And Holy Thursday is all about remembering the Last Supper that Jesus had with his disciples. Jesus and his disciples, they're celebrating a Passover meal together. Jesus knows that his crucifixion and his resurrection are imminent. That's why people call it the Last Supper. But we got to remember, this is where Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper. This was the very first instance of communion. I want to read from Luke chapter 22, verses 19 and 20. "And Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you.'" What an unbelievable privilege that we have as a church family to participate in the Lord's Supper together, to remember his body and blood that were given up for us. Our Savior bled and he died for all of our sins. And we remember his body that he gave up for us, and we remember his blood, and we participate in communion because Jesus founded it and he told us to remember him in that way. In just a few moments, there will be a communion tray that's passed through your aisle. The cups are stacked in two, and one is containing the bread and the other is containing the juice. And these elements represent the body and blood of Christ. All followers of Jesus are encouraged to participate in communion with us. We ask that you would spend time in prayerful examination of your own life and light of the cross before partaking of the bread and the cup. May we all remember our Savior's sacrifice for us and the debt of sin that was paid so that we could receive salvation. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we love you so much. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. On this Good Friday, we stand in humble awe of your sacrifice. We remember your blood that was shed and your body that was given for us. Thank you for paying the penalty for our sins so that we could have eternal life with you. We trust in you and in you alone for our salvation. Thank you for what you did for us on the cross. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Church family, there's no rush at all, but whenever you're ready, please stand as we continue to sing together and worship our Savior Jesus. Of everything, the weight of all I've done.
nailed into your hands. And all your love bled for me. All your blood in crimson streaks. All your death is hell to feet. A cross meant to kill is my victory. Oh, your amazingness I've seen and tasted. It's running through my veins. Can't escape its grip. In you my soul is safe. You will cover everything. All your love bled for me. All your blood in crimson streets. All your death is hell's defeat. A cross meant to kill is my victory. You are the Lamb of God who takes away our sin. Takes away our sin. The Holy Lamb of God makes us alive again. Makes us alive again. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away our sin. Who takes away our sin.
Great love. You met me at my lowest moment. You saw me at my very worst. When I expected disappointment, love was all I. My sin was deep, your grace was deeper. My shame was wide, your arms were wider. My guilt was great, your love was greater still. You ran to me when I was naked. To your light again.
grace was deeper, my shame was wide, your arms were wider, my guilt was great, your love was greater still. Your love, my sin was, my sin was deep, your grace was deeper, my shame was wide, your arms were wider, my guilt was great, your love was greater still.
How deep, how wide, how far, how high, the love of my Savior, the love of Christ.
How deep, how wide, how far, how high, the love of my Savior, the love of Christ. And how deep, how wide, how far, how high, the love of my Savior, the love of Christ. Yeah. 'Cause my sin was deep, the grace was deeper, my shame was wide, your arms were wider, my guilt was great, your love was greater still. My sin was deep, your grace was deeper than the sea. My shame was wide, your arms were wider, my guilt was great, your love was greater still.
One more time, my sin was deep. My sin was deep, grace was deeper, my shame was wide, your arms were wider, and my guilt was great, your love was greater still, your love was greater still. We're going to go to God's word again. 1 John chapter 2, verse 2 says this: He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. This great God who loves us gave his life as a payment for us. There is no debt left, but our slate is wiped clean. He is worthy to be praised for that miracle. We're going to sing that right now. I hear
the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small, shall their weakness wash and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the left. A heart of stone. Jesus made it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Oh,
Jesus made it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. My sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed. Washed it white as snow. Sing, oh praise the one. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Our voices, oh praise. Praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead.
Thank you so much for joining us for our Good Friday service this evening. We hope to see you all Sunday as we get to celebrate our resurrected Savior, Jesus Christ. Have a great rest of your weekend, church.
Thanks again for listening today. We'd love to hear from you. If you'd like more information about our church, or if you just want to share what God's been doing in your life, drop us a line, give us a call. Again, may God bless you.